that Brianna needs some help right now. She's possibly in a lot of trouble. Brianna, you know we all love you. You know we all need you here. I know something's wrong here, so please, just if you get this or somebody you know does and can find you, get a hold of us. Let us know you're okay.
That was Mike Ketchmark, father of missing person Brianna Vibert. Obviously very concerned. She has a lot of family that's concerned, including four children that don't know where their mother is. She's been missing for more than 2 years now. It's coming up on three this July. And this is a case, I think, that needs some help. There's a few different possibilities that are going on here. I'm hoping that together we can raise some exposure to it. So together, let's turn on the searchlight for Brianna Vibert. Welcome back to Brainscratch Searchlight. I'm John Lorden, and thank you so much for spending some time with me here today, opening your heart to another case. I also want to give a very big thank you to Brainscratcher Misty, who contributed a bunch of research that got me kickstarted on this case. Thank you so much, Misty. Really appreciate the help. But let's take a look. This is a picture of Brianna Vibert. She's been missing since July 2017. So obviously that is a long period of time. We've got a lot of family that's concerned. And I also just want to be a little sensitive to the fact that I believe she may have been adopted, and we've essentially got two sets of parents, I think, that are very concerned here. To be honest with you guys, I couldn't exactly figure out which set is which. We do have one pair of parents that are being very active with the media. We've got another pair of parents that I can see aren't quite getting that same media attention, but they're working social media the best they can as well. So a lot of concern, and I just want to remain sensitive to the fact, I know feelings can get tough when you're talking about a situation like that, but honestly, I think we need to focus on this situation. It's about Brianna, and can we raise exposure to her case? Can we get some tips called in? Can we get some more help with this? So I hope that everyone's pulling together and working on the same team with that. But I did just want to put out there that I do understand there might be some tough feelings with that type of situation. Starting over at Namus, Brianna Jade Vibert. And you see her middle name is actually spelt with a Y in it, J-A-Y-D-E. A white Caucasian female. Now, here for the date of last contact, they're saying July 17th, 2017. Other reports that I'm seeing are saying it was actually July 15th. I have looked at her social media, and her social media seems to be supporting that story. Her last posts are from July 14th. So I think July 15th might actually be more accurate. Missing from Flint Township in Michigan at the age of 24 years old. Currently, she would be 27 years old. Stands at 5'9", weighs 120 pounds. For circumstances of last disappearance, last seen on foot on Saginaw Road in Flint Township. And we are going to get some more details with that, but unfortunately, they're not here in the profile. For physical description, red or auburn hair, reddish brown is how it's described. She does have brown eyes. For distinctive physical features, we've got a few. She's got tattoos. Savannah is on one wrist. Maddox is on the other. I believe those are the names of two of her children. She has a skeleton key on her right foot. On her right shoulder, on the back, it's written family, and there's kind of a circle around it, and they're showing here a different tattoo that I think is similar to it, so I'm not positive if the words are exactly a match from this one. Here's a picture of hers, but the quality's so low, I can't make out the detail on the words. It might be the same words, so if it is the same words, it's something like pride, loyalty, honor, love, strength. But it could be that that has been changed. I don't know. She might have her children's names around her, around the word family. So it might be a little bit different. She also has on her right shoulder on the front side, the Mad Hatter's hat. It's noting she has very pale skin with freckles. And I do see in some photos of her, it looks like she uses makeup and you can't really see the freckles on her face too much. But then I see on other pictures where they're showing up. So very fair skin. You can also see that they are on her shoulders as well. So pale skin with freckles. For clothing and accessories, they're saying that she went missing with a black, yellow, white, gray Vera Bradley purse. Now, we do have something being described as a personal bag of hers that is found as we're going through the details of this story. I'm kind of seeing unconfirmed information that that might actually be her purse. So I don't know if the purse is still missing or not, but I just want to get that detail out there. For clothing, black leggings with a tan cream 3/4 length sleeve shirt. For additional case information, nothing listed, no transportation listed. We do have two vehicles of interest with this story, so keep that in mind. But let's learn a little bit more about Brianna before we get into those details. So I dived into her Facebook page a bit and learned quite a bit about her. She's a fan of Fail Army, True TV, Kevin Hart, Beyonce, Miley Cyrus, the New York Giants, the Yankees, Detroit Lions, the Red Wings, many fitness personalities and companies. Also a big fan of children's products. Obviously, she's a young mother with four children, so that's a huge part of her life. You can really get that from her Facebook profile. Also a fan of Oprah Winfrey and the Dalai Lama. She's also a divorced mother of four and dating someone new. And it seems like things might have not been going well for her at the time leading up to her disappearance. Her Facebook posts seem to suggest some type of emotional struggle that she's having. Some of the posts seem like she's arguing with someone, but it's not exactly clear who. I'm also seeing posts where it appears that she is speaking to her boyfriend. She references him, and then it looks like she's having dialogue back and forth with him. But his messages are all missing, and it's possible that his Facebook account may have been completely removed or deleted. Either that or it's severely locked down, and I'm just not able to find it. On June 9th, 2017, she posted, "I literally just go through the motions every day of normal day-to-day crap, all stuck in my thoughts and can't talk about what's in my head. I barely have friends or anyone to count on besides my boyfriend, and that's a lot for one person to handle, so that's not fair to him. I hate feeling so angry all the time. I'm really just angry at myself. Angry I'm not going anywhere in life. Angry I don't have my own stuff or can't do anything for myself, let alone anyone else. I'm just angry, and it's no one's fault but my own. I need a vacation, a new environment, something." Now, after that, pretty soon after that, something new does come her way. It seems that she starts a job, I believe, at a local Middle Eastern cuisine restaurant called Taboon Grand Blanc. On June 15th, 2017, she posted, "First day of work, wish me luck." And then for her employment, Taboon is what's listed. So I'm assuming that's when she started there, though it could be incorrect, but that's what it looks like from her Facebook profile. However, despite starting a new job, her emotional struggle seemed to continue. On June 22nd, 2017, she posted, "When you're the only one who wants better, it's annoying to be around people who don't. Can't wait to bust my butt and make this money. Come see me at work today." And then we lead up to her last posts that came, I believe it's one day before she went missing, but possibly up to 3 days. It depends on if she really went missing on the 15th or the 17th. But the final posts, the first one is, "I respect the truth, always have and always will. I know what I've got. I know where I stand. Everything else is irrelevant. Meddle in my life and try to disturb my peace. I dare you." So once again, I'm just getting that tone from that message in particular. She's arguing with someone. I don't know who this is. Some of the things leading up to this seem like she's worried about female friends of her boyfriend that are coming to her Facebook page to kind of check her out. And she's basically saying, "I'm not going to friend any of these people. If that's what you're here for, forget it." But this message seems a little more direct. I don't know who she's speaking to. A few hours after that was her final post. And that says, "Anyone know a cheap but good piercer? I just want the other side of my nose done. And as you can see in this photo, she does have her left side already pierced. So apparently she was looking to get the other one done, but she went missing. So let's continue with the news articles now that we know a bit about Brianna as a person. Over at clickondetroit.com, Flint Township police are looking for a missing 24-year-old woman who was last seen leaving a gas station. And here they actually have a photo of her from surveillance footage at the gas station. Also, take a look at her right arm. There's some discussion about what's going on with her right arm that we're going to get to. And this photo is probably the best way that we have to try to understand that. Brianna Vibert was last seen at a Marathon gas station on July 15th around 1 a.m. getting into a red Pontiac Aztec with an unknown black male. So her father, in that interview where I showed you clips of it at the start of this episode, goes into a bit more detail about this. The Marathon gas station, I believe, is close to where she was living. The person that works at that gas station was very familiar with her. And the person that works at that gas station says it was clear to them that the black male she was interacting with was a stranger to her. And it seems like the person working at the gas station was kind of cautioning her, hey, you know, don't just go off with this guy. They say that he leaves for 10 minutes, comes back, speaks to her again, and then she decides to go off in the car with him. Now, I know some of you are probably thinking this, so I'm just going to put it out there. I have not seen any information about her struggling with any type of narcotics. The Facebook profile that I looked at, there was one company that she seemed to support, which looked like it might be a glass manufacturer for smoking items, pretty much like a bong company, something like that. That's really the only thing that's even close to a reference that I've seen. I haven't heard anything from her family saying that she was struggling in that way. No other comments that I can find. But when you talk about the logistics of she's talking to someone that seems like a stranger, the person goes away for 10 minutes, they come back, she gets in his car, and then they go somewhere else, that seems like we need to consider that possibility a little bit for me. And that's what happens here. Now, we do know where they go to from there. We'll get to that with the story, but let's just take a look. This is the Marathon. So I believe this is the correct gas station. I'm not 100% on it because I keep seeing this address in several articles. And when I go look at that address, there's no gas station anywhere around that. This seems to be the Marathon that is on Miller Road. It's not terribly far from the other address that I'm seeing, but certainly not near it. So I don't know if there's just a bad address that's floating around that, or if I have this completely wrong. And for some reason, there is a Subway that's at the other intersection that looks like it was formerly a gas station, but I looked back on older street views and it was still a Subway back when she went missing. So I don't think that's the right one. I think this is the Marathon where she met up with the black male at 1 a.m. Now, here is some surveillance footage, once again, of the two of them and his vehicle. And early on in the investigation, of course, this is a big point of focus for the investigation. People want to know who this guy is, what happened that night. And essentially, investigators do find him. It's a little bit of an interesting story, especially when you hear her mother talk about it. So I'm going to save that for a little bit later in the video. But here at NBC25News.com, police say they have located and spoken to the male driver of the red Pontiac Aztec. Police say he has been cooperating with the investigation and is not considered a suspect in her disappearance at this time. Now, information I'm finding says that basically when she does get into his vehicle, they wind up going to an adult entertainment club that she used to work at as a shot girl. So we're going to get some more detail about that as well. But essentially, he lets the police know where they went. I think she had some friends there, and they kind of support the fact that she actually did show up there. He then takes her to a different gas station and drops her off. And there's footage from that gas station also about that shows her walking off and shows the Pontiac Aztec driving off in a separate direction. According to police, the investigation has revealed that Vibert was last seen at the mobile gas station at 3841 South Saginaw Street on Saturday, July 15th at around 2:45 a.m. So that is the second gas station. And that's what we have here. I'm showing you this line because the gas station is here just a little bit to the south. And it says that she is seen walking off towards Atherton Road, which is up here. And if we turn on the satellite view, we can see we don't have a lot of businesses, unfortunately. We've got like a barbershop over here, a foot and ankle clinic. I mean, the likelihood that they're going to have cameras that are facing the road, not very high. So unfortunately, she heads for an intersection where we just don't have a lot of surveillance options. And yeah, that's the last comment here is just police say it's believed that she was last seen walking northbound on South Saginaw Street toward Atherton Road. Other sources I'm seeing are saying that there's possibly another vehicle involved here, someone that she was speaking to that was in another vehicle. And here's some detail on that over at WNEM.com. Investigators now say they have received information that she was seen talking with someone in a green or teal Ford Ranger or S10 Chevy style pickup truck in the gas station parking lot. The occupants of that vehicle are being asked to call Flint Township Police. I find it a little interesting that when it came to the first vehicle, they kind of put information out into the public and it seems like they got in contact with that person very quickly. Here, it seems like they must have some form of surveillance, especially if the truck was actually in the gas station parking lot, but we're not seeing any photos released. We're not getting a description of the driver or anything like that. So I'm just curious. I don't know if this lead has actually been closed out. This isn't a case that's getting that level of coverage, unfortunately, but this is something that they're looking into at the time of the disappearance after they get past that first hoop of getting contact with the black male that has the Pontiac Aztec. So this is literally it's posted July 19th, 2017. So you can see things are moving fairly quickly when it comes to this case. WNEM.com posts another story about several women that are missing from the area. I kind of struggle with coverage like this. Ultimately, I find that it sometimes puts together a story that doesn't necessarily reflect the truth of what's going on. When I've looked into groupings like this, and I did a really deep dive into this when there was a lot of minority kids that were disappearing in the DC area, and that kind of raised up and became this whole big, it was kind of a myth in terms of what was going on with these kids. I started literally tracking those cases individually, and one by one they were getting solved and they had no connection to each other. So I always struggle a little bit when I see news organizations do this, try to lump all these cases together. You know, does it make a cool headline and grab a little attention? Yes. But when it comes down to actually learning about these cases, the pertinent facts, and I mean, just look, this cluster of pictures says it all. What do you really remember when you look at a collage like this? For me personally, I just wonder about the effectiveness of it in terms of raising exposure. But several women in mid-Michigan disappeared without a trace. She was fun. She was a good mom. She was very mature for her age, very insightful. She was a wise soul. I miss her very much, said Bobby Jo Stone, Vibert's mother. And Bobby Jo is someone that's getting a lot of press around this case, which I think is a good thing. Her comments, you know, whenever you can get comments from the mother to help raise exposure, I think people really connect with that, and I'm glad that she's working to do that. Once again, just to remain sensitive, I don't know if Bobby Jo Stone is her biological mother or her adopted mother. I'm just thankful that someone's out there trying to raise the exposure and do this. The not knowing is the worst thing. I think all of our family, we are bouncing back and forth between, no, she's got to be out there, she's got to be alive, and then trying to be realistic and trying to prepare yourself for the worst, Stone said. With so many missing in the same area, some wonder if a sex trafficking ring is targeting women who walk the streets in that area. And this is another aspect to articles like this. I think there is a vision that a lot of people have about sex trafficking. And here they're even kind of saying it. It's a sex trafficking ring. Sex trafficking can happen just with one other person being in control of someone. It doesn't necessarily take a ring or a cartel or some type of large, super organized organization to do this thing. And unfortunately, I think for a lot of us, we just kind of have this picture. Oh, that's what sex trafficking is. It's this industry where people are working together and they're trading women and sending them, you know, across borders and doing stuff like that. It doesn't have to be that large. And could a story like this fit into a much smaller version of some type of sex trafficking situation, or even yes, a ring or a cartel of some kind? Sure, absolutely. We have someone that's vulnerable walking around in the middle of the night. I don't know why the black male took her to this other gas station. I mean, you guys already met up at a gas station and then you went to a club. Why are you coming back and then being dropped off at another gas station that's a few miles away from the first gas station? Is that necessarily closer to her home? I don't know, because I don't have her home address. It just seems weird to me that the gas station seems to be a point where you drop her off. I mean, why couldn't he have dropped her off at home? Apparently, that's not what she wanted. But are you going to hang out at a gas station at 2:45 in the morning until the next morning when you're ready to go wake up your boyfriend and try to work things out? I'm really struggling with what that last gas station stop is about. Unfortunately, we don't have great detail. But back to the article. The FBI and the Burton, Flint Township, and City of Flint police departments have not been able to find any conclusive links between the eight women. I'm thankful the article is at least putting that in, because they're making it clear, hey, look, we've put these women together, but honestly, we've got all these law enforcement organizations looking at it as a potential theory. They're not seeing anything there. The departments all met about 2 months ago and were not able to find any ties or common associates connected among them, except for being seen at some point in or near the south side of Flint. Now, I don't want to discount the possibility that something could have happened to a few of these women that is the same party is responsible for it. I think that's certainly a possibility. But clubbing this all together, throwing the term sex trafficking ring in on top of it, I just don't think that's fair to these stories. I think these stories deserve to be told individually and given all the time and attention on a person-by-person basis, even if that gets less clicks. But that's just me personally. Thankfully, we've got a hero organization to me that steps into this story, Texas EquiSearch. And we can see March 6th of 2018, they make a post on their website, Texas EquiSearch, Ohio Midwest chapter will be conducting a search for Brianna Vibert and Teresa Town Woolard. So basically, out of this group of eight, Texas EquiSearch has decided for some reason to focus on these two and to do some specific searches. We don't know what the information is that is pointing them towards doing these particular searches or in the areas where they're looking, but they are working on those two cases in particular. Here's another article about it. Unfortunately, it had to be rescheduled. Weather does certainly affect search efforts. Bring Our Missing Home Incorporated, the Midwest chapter of Texas EquiSearch, the Burton Police Department, the Flint Township Police Department, and the Genesee County Search and Rescue Team will be conducting a search on March 24th. That really moves me when I see so many different organizations that are working together to help on search efforts like that. That's really special to me, but it also leads me to believe that there must have been some type of intelligence that they got about where to search, because it's not like you're going to get Texas EquiSearch out there and just say, hey, she went missing in this town. What do you guys think? There's a lot of thought and work that goes into specifically where these searches are going to be conducted, and especially if you have the police department throwing resources at it as well. So it kind of suggests to me that some information must have come into them. Now, was it accurate or not? I don't know. The search for the two women was originally scheduled for March 10th, but had to be rescheduled due to weather conditions. And Dave Rader, we talked about him within the past few weeks on Searchlight. Director of the Midwest chapter of Texas EquiSearch said their organization sometimes finds murder weapons and found three women alive within the last month. Pat Lamson, a founding member, search manager, and training coordinator for Genesee County Search and Rescue Team, said their missing person response team is local and knows the area. So once again, we've just got really good experts working together to help try to find these two ladies. Unfortunately, I don't see any updates after the fact. Of course, if something critical would have been found, I think we would have seen some type of news kick out about that. So I think it's pretty safe to say that they didn't find anything of huge value. Or if it was of huge value, it's something that law enforcement's keeping under wraps because maybe that is helping to protect the prosecution phase in some way. Another article from WNEM.com. We're trying to give the family some closure, Raider said. We want to bring their loved ones home. And let's face it, we don't know who we're going to bring home. We have 8 missing women in and around the Flint area. So we're covering a lot of variant today in a short amount of time in hopes to bring one of the missing home. So there, even though they're noting they're specifically looking for information related to 2 of the women, Raider's staying open to the fact that, hey, you know, we know that there's 8 missing in this area. Anything that we find, if it's going to apply to one of those cases, we're thankful and we're just trying to find it. Mom speaks out. This article is from July 13th, 2018. So essentially, we get to the 1-year anniversary mark. It's hard to believe it's been an entire year and somebody can just disappear from the face of the earth, said Bobby Jo Stone, Vibert's mother. Her babies, they miss their mom. I don't think she is voluntarily out there. Very interesting and important consideration because some of the language on the Facebook page shows that she sure seems like she's struggling. Information even from her mother seems to be pointing towards the fact that she's probably in a bad relationship. She's just getting divorced. She's coming out of a marriage and he's the father of 3 of her 4 children. A lot of stress is going on. She seems like she's not really being effective in life. So it's tough. Is there a possibility that she could have fled her life, just left everything behind? I think there's a possibility. I don't know how big it is. And you are talking about her leaving 4 children behind, which I'm sure would be extremely difficult. And even if that is the case, I don't know that her family would be able to see that as an option. So I totally get where her mother's coming from here. I know for a fact if she was alive, she would be in contact with someone. I fear that she's being held against her will. So another possibility there, and there might be something to that as well. Like I said, these trafficking situations don't take these big giant organizations that I think that kind of makes it harder to believe in those situations. And it really doesn't take that at all. She could be being controlled by someone with love. It could be someone that's saying they're going to love her. They're going to take care of her. Could be narcotics. If narcotics are a part of the equation here, could be money. We know it seems like she was struggling for money as well. She had just started a new job. It could be someone that said, hey, I can take care of all these problems for you. Just come with me. So interesting. And it's tough because in that situation, you're talking about, well, but that's not really against her will, right? Well, actually, if you've got one of those 3 control mechanisms or more going at the same time, you'd be pretty surprised what seems like your will versus the person that's controlling you. Just this past Wednesday, Stone was shocked to see somebody signed into Vibert's Snapchat account. Very concerning there because you're talking a year after the fact. That was very alarming to me, her mother said. I don't know if it's her. I don't know if it's somebody fraudulently signing in as her, but it's certainly a sign of something. I don't know enough about Snapchat to know if there is some automated processes that could look like a sign in or if there's something that could happen to her account that would make it appear like a sign in. It's kind of strange to me that it seemed to happen almost a year after she theoretically stopped using that service. So I'm just wondering if there was some type of automated something that would have done that, but pretty concerning on any regard. And especially for people that are looking for signs of life. I mean, to see something like that is like, hey, oh my God, someone just logged into her account. Brianna Jade, I've always told you that no matter where you are, if you call, I will come for you. If somebody has her, you need to understand your actions have a profound effect on more than just Brianna, and her family loves her and wants her to come home. So over at crimeonline.com, they get some information. It's kind of a strange source, so that's why I didn't really integrate it with all the news stuff. It's almost rumor territory. I mean, I don't think that it's out and out lies, but you'll see what I'm talking about when we discuss what the source is. On the night of July 14th, Vibert reportedly left the home after getting into an argument with her boyfriend. Laura Nail, the girlfriend of the missing mother's ex-husband, told Crime Online. So this information is coming from her ex-husband's current girlfriend. And like I said, I don't think that, you know, we rule that out because of it, but it's just a very interesting chain. There's a lot of kind of connections for this information. And if you've ever played a game of telephone, you know why I'm treading cautiously when it comes to this. But so we're now hearing that there was a very specific fight that happened between her and her boyfriend before she left that night and went to the first gas station at 1 a.m. Nail explained that Vibert's current boyfriend claimed, so here's the chain of dialogue, right? That she was screaming and throwing things. Nail explained that the mother of four was denied visitation because her home lacked running water due to a broken well. Now, Laura might know specifically about that because she's dating the guy that is the father of the kids. So I would say that he would probably certainly have firsthand knowledge if visitation was denied because they were saying, hey, you don't even have running water there. We're not going to let you see the kids. At an emotional level, think about the dynamics she's going through at this point. Probably expecting to spend time with her children, can't because the house isn't in the right shape for doing that. Already feeling terrible because she feels like she's just started her new job. I'm sure she hasn't even got her paycheck yet. And then getting in a fight with her boyfriend about all this. There's a lot of emotional turmoil that's going on here before she leaves for that first gas station. Nail said surveillance video from the Marathon gas station reportedly showed a panicked, anxious Vibert with blood on the inside of her right forearm. So that's why I was asking you to take a look at that picture. And let's bounce back at it real quick. Unfortunately, it's not great quality. Even the coloring's kind of thrown off. To me, it looks quite a bit dark for being blood. And I do know she has tattoos. We've heard it described that she has a tattoo on her wrists. So this section that's kind of close to her wrist, that could be the name of one of her children. There is something that's beyond that, kind of closer back. I know in the description, I believe it said she also had a tattoo of a feather. Actually, I read that on a different description of her tattoos. I know that she also has a feather tattoo. So I'm not 100% if there's really blood seen here. That wasn't reported in any of the official news stories. I'm just trying to give this as straight as I can to you guys. So that's a new detail here. And maybe they're seeing blood there because of a story they're being told from her current boyfriend. Her boyfriend allegedly claimed that during their argument, Vibert grabbed a knife and cut her arm. Very interesting story, and when she's not around to say that's not what happened, it makes me wonder about the possibility. Is there some other type of violence that was going on in this house? According to her mother, it seems like this was a violent relationship. So I don't know. Something we really have to consider. There's a lot of things about this case that feel like a domestic violence type situation to me. The mother of four is said to have asked a man for a ride to a restaurant and left the gas station with him. Vibert is said to have visited a local adult entertainment club where she previously worked as a shot girl. According to Nail, employees said she arrived in pretty bad shape and left with the man who gave her a ride. Now, unfortunately, we don't know what that's referring to. Do they mean in pretty bad shape emotionally? Do they mean in pretty bad shape physically? Do they mean that she seemed like she was extremely drunk or something else? We don't know. That's literally the only source that I've seen that's saying anything about this, outside of other sources that are citing this information. Then we have her arrive at the mobile gas station at 2:45. Nail told Crime Online that surveillance cameras there appear to catch her stumbling while holding onto shelves to stay upright. So when you combine that with the comment, that could be painting things in a different direction. And just once again, I'm concerned that there's some type of involvement of narcotics with this scene. It just seems like it. We've got all these stressors going on in her life. We have one night in particular where all the stressors are hitting at a max. Her supposedly talking to a person where it seemed clear to the person that's watching this conversation, she didn't really know him. He disappears for 10 minutes, comes back. Now she's being seen in pretty bad shape. She gets back to another gas station. She's stumbling while holding on to shelves. It seems to be painting a picture. Afterward, Nail said that she was filmed walking in the parking lot with the man who she had gotten multiple rides from traveling in the opposite direction. So it seems like he leaves at that point and she goes walking off. Days later, police reportedly found a bag of Vibert's personal belongings in a ditch located not far from her Flint home. Nail said there's speculation that the mother of four was asking a friend for a ride and had planned to retrieve the bag, but never did. I don't know what sense that makes. That really doesn't make any sense to me. Even if I had a suitcase with me and I was asking a friend for a ride, I would just ask him, hey, can I throw this in the trunk and, you know, just leave it there for the night or something. You're going to leave your personal belongings in a ditch close to your home with an expectation to go back there and find them again and that they're still going to be there and they're still going to be okay. Now, here we're not getting a clear statement if it's her purse or not. There's comments at Web Sleuths from people that are claiming to be much closer to this case, but unfortunately they're not verified insiders, so even that information I don't want to weave into this too hard. But some of those statements are saying it was actually her purse that's found in that ditch. Makes me concerned, especially if that ditch is close to her home. I'm also wondering if that purse is seen in any of the surveillance footage, but unfortunately we've only got some snapshots here. Now, she is wearing something. She's got a strap around her body. Is that the purse that's part of that strap? That means that it would have been with her earlier that night. So that's definitely a concern. I don't know. There's a lot. I feel like I'm putting a puzzle together, but we're missing like half the pieces. And that's not all. Stone, her mother, said there are no new updates regarding her daughter's case. However, she did call attention to the man who allegedly picked Vibert up, alleging that he was in possession of her phone for 6 days before charging and turning it on, alerting police. So the story here is he takes her back to that second gas station and he's leaving, but her phone somehow either gets left with him or left in his vehicle. Now, what's interesting to me about this thing that she's saying that he had it for 6 days before turning it on, alerting police, the articles about police speaking to him are published literally within days of her disappearance. This article is from July 18th, 2017. So we're talking, if she did disappear on the 15th, which I believe she did, only 3 days later, police have already spoken to this guy. So this 6 day window that she's talking about, one of two things is going on here. Either that date is wrong, or police spoke to this guy who maybe didn't know her phone was in his car. And then a couple days after they speak to him, he decides he's going to charge up this phone and turn it on. Something very odd about all that. And like I said, it just, I don't know if it's the 6 days thing is wrong. Cause it's certainly within 6 days that they've figured out who that guy is and they're speaking to him. We have time keep passing. July 15th, 2019. It's been 2 years since. Stone said they have not heard any new tips. It's even harder for Vibert's children, who are getting old enough to start wondering what happened to their mom. Questions I can't answer, questions nobody has been able to answer, and it's heartbreaking to watch this little 8-year-old girl grow up wondering, would mommy be proud of me, Stone said. She has a lot of questions, a lot of fears about what happened to mommy. The final update on this from late September 2019, CrimeStoppers billboards help with searching for missing woman. And here we have a photo of the billboard. It does say here that family and friends paid for the billboards. They've put up two billboards along Saginaw Street, essentially trying to raise exposure and get some more tips called in from there. So other websites you'll find in the description box down below. The Help Find Brianna Facebook group is down there. Please follow that, join it, especially if you're local to the area. You want to keep up to date on possible search efforts that are going on. Here is a little bit of a better picture of that surveillance footage, and it certainly looks like that's a purse that she has to me. So once again, we're not 100% sure that it's a purse that's found in the ditch. It just said a bag with some of her personal items. But I'd be pretty surprised if it wasn't that purse. If you want to see the comments that seem to suggest it is the purse, I'll also have the Web Sleuths thread down below. I looked into some Reddit threads, and they just were not very helpful to the case, so I cut those out. But you guys can search for those if you want to look for those. So here's kind of what I'm thinking in terms of theories. Let me know what you think about these, and if you have any others in the comments down below. The things that I'm seeing from this case are really making me worried about some type of domestic violence situation. What if this whole story that we've heard is true? This guy did pick her up, took her to the adult entertainment club. People saw her there. He took her back to the second gas station. They have footage of her there. She goes walking off from there. What if she makes it home? And what if that fight isn't quite done? And what if things escalate out of control? That's a situation I'm very concerned about. I would hope that investigators possibly got a search order for not her Facebook activity. Well, I'd hope they get that too, but possibly her boyfriend's Facebook activity, or maybe check his cell phone activity as well. Obviously, she doesn't have her cell phone on her at that point, so we can't really use that as a lead. Her boyfriend has not been named publicly in any of these articles, so I'm also not going to name him. But I'm sure investigators know his name, and I hope that they're looking into that. It's just, in terms of the priorities of possibilities here, I'd be looking at that one really, really strong. Outside of that, possibly crime of opportunity. You have someone reportedly walking around in, quote, bad shape, possibly stumbling at the last place that she was recorded at. And then she goes walking off on her own, 2:45 in the morning. That might be a bad situation in itself. Trafficking situation, I think it's a possibility. I don't think we could rule it out. Do I think that that whole group of eight, everyone is part of some type of trafficking ring? No, I think the odds of that are extremely, extremely low, especially when you have all these experts that have looked into it and they're just not seeing any linkage. But smaller situations, I think, could be happening around that. So I think we do have to stay open to that. I think we also have to stay open to the possibility of her escaping her life, deciding that things were going so bad there that she just couldn't straighten them out. And then now she wasn't even able to see her kids. Maybe she thought she wasn't going to be able to correct that situation for a long time, wasn't going to be able to see her kids for a long time. And that eased her kind of deciding to leave. It's just another possibility I think we can't quite rule out. It's also kind of interesting to me that her boyfriend's account is, like I said, either deleted or so locked down I can't see it. So I can't really find any information where he's being helpful in terms of the search efforts, which should show up, you know, on the Facebook group, if nothing else. I mean, we've got a Facebook group dedicated to trying to find her, and I'm not seeing any comments from him being made there either. I do see comments from her ex-husband. I wanted to share one of those with you. This is from her ex-husband, Eric Vibert. It was a post made on July 19th, 2017, so within the first week that she's missing. A lot of people in the Flint area have only known Brina for a very short time. Since she has been in the area, she has been in very much over her head, getting into a lot of things she shouldn't. This is not the person most know of her. She is a very kind, warm-hearted person that always made everyone laugh. She was the best mother of four beautiful children. I can say this because I was married to her, and three out of the four kids we had together. She was a stay-at-home mom and very much a country outdoor girl. Her kids were always put first. She got involved with the wrong people. Someone out there has her against her will. She was born to be a mom, and I believe postpartum depression got the best of her. If anyone knows anything at all, even if you're not 100% sure it's related to her, call it in. These four babies will have to live with this forever. We just want her brought back to us. No one is perfect. We all make mistakes. No kid deserves to lose their mother. I just want to send all my best to all of her family, all of her friends, and especially her children. And I hope you all find the answers that you are seeking sooner rather than later. Before I end today's video, I have several people to thank. New patrons, Jessica Lennox. Thank you so much, Jessica. Annika or Annika, I'm going to say it both ways just in case, and Kim Tannehill. Thank you so much. If you'd like to support the channel, you can head over to www.lordenarts.com where you can sign up for Patreon, PayPal, or check out the merch. We've got our new Searchlight merchandise there as well. It all helps keep me here doing what I love doing, helping in these cases, and spending time with you guys. Take care, everyone. Stay safe. Stay healthy. I'll see you back here on Friday with a brand new episode of Brainscratch on the Lorden Arts channel.